Bob, I'm just going to turn it right over to you once we get. I'll just open the meeting. We'll do a roll call vote, then I'm going to turn it over to you.
Sounds good.
Say we could just jump on it right away.
Okay, we're good, Bob. Anytime you're ready.
Okay. Go ahead, Scott.
Okay. You ready, Bob?
Ready.
Okay. Okay, everyone, I'd like to thank everyone for coming to the special meeting of the Board of Water Sewer Commissioners via Zoom. So we're going to open our meeting right now. So I'm going to do a roll call vote. So we'll start with Roger.
Yeah, I'll make a motion to open the meeting. And
do I have a second?
Second.
Okay, roll call vote.
Benavides, aye.
Bednarik, aye.
And O'Brien, aye. Okay, we are in an official meeting. At this time, I'd like to turn it over to our superintendent, Bob Bozakowski, who's going to do our presentation. Anybody who has any questions, if you could hold them to the end, and Bob will explain to you how we're going to do it. Okay, Bob, all yours.
Thank you. I want to welcome you all to this presentation, this public presentation, to the planning efforts undertaken by the Board of Water and Sewer Commissioners to plan for the water pollution facility upgrade. Just like to introduce a few people. We have JP Jolly. He's with Waterworth. He's the CEO and founder of Waterworth, and also he helps. Waterworth is a company that does financial planning for water and sewer utilities. Also Kevin Olson, he's with the engineering firm Wright Pierce. His firm did the engineering assessment that we're going to cover tonight, and Waterworth, JP Jolly, helped us put the financial plan together tonight that we are going to review tonight. So, if you want to submit questions through the chat tonight, we ask that you just submit clear and well-worded questions so that we can understand them and do our best to answer them. If you can also identify the section that we're going to cover. So this is a six-part plan that we've developed for this effort, and then that'll help us organize our thoughts. So with that, I'm going to bring up my presentation here, and we'll get started. Okay, can everybody hear me? All right. So we're going to talk about the water pollution control facility upgrade. Just a little bit of background before we get started. So the treatment facility is located at 116 Walker Street. This is on the south end of town near Gladding and Hearn Shipbuilding. In 2020, this facility treated 1.3 billion gallons of wastewater. The average daily flow from that year was just shy of 3.7 million gallons a day. This facility operates 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 365 days a year. It's made up of about 110 miles of collection pipes, 2,350 manholes, 17 pump stations, and the treatment facility. The original plant and the collection system was installed in the 1960s. Most of this infrastructure was funded by federal grants, clean water grants, and it involved primary treatment and secondary treatment. Primary treatment takes out the solids that'll settle or float to the surface. Secondary treatment, we call those solids suspended solids. Secondary treatment works on the dissolved solids, where we actually grow microorganisms to feed on those dissolved organics. We'll get into more of that later. In the mid to late 1980s, there was a major upgrade. This is about 30 to 35 years ago. This was as the town was going through a big growth spurt. And so the capacity of the plant was expanded. In 1993, we added chlorination and dechlorination. In 1997, we added odor control to be more conscious of our neighbors. And then in 2016, we switched from chlorine gas for disinfection to liquid. It's a much safer process. Currently we are waiting for a new discharge permit from the federal government, EPA. And we, this new permit will require us to meet nitrogen limits. So over the last 3 to 4 years, the board has done a great job in laying out a plan and to prepare for this upgrade. It involved a very extensive engineering assessment that we'll go through tonight, a financial plan, the replacement of water meters, the design of sewer rates, and mitigation of infiltration and inflow. This is groundwater and stormwater that seeps into the collection system. And then finally, regionalization. So we'll go through each of these stages. So to begin with the engineering assessment, the report that was developed was an integrated water resource management plan in accordance with MassDEP requirements. And this plan looked at drinking water infrastructure, sewer infrastructure, and stormwater. It's a 20-year planning document. The wastewater portion, or the comprehensive wastewater management plan, is also in compliance with MassDEP requirements and serves as a basis for design for the plant, okay, for the upgrade. These planning documents also allow us favorable interest rates from the state revolving loan fund. Okay, that's the primary go-to fund for funding these types of water and sewer infrastructure projects. So the standard interest rate is 2% for the construction portion of the project. The portions that involve nitrogen removal will be eligible for 0% interest rates. And according to Kevin, he believes that that should amount to about 25% of the construction project. So we'll go through this plan give you the highlights. So on the collection system, these are the pipes that collect the wastewater. There was a 2019 study of inflow and infiltration. So inflow is stormwater that seeps into the collection system, and infiltration is groundwater. And so when you use water in your home and it discharges down your drains, it flows out to the street and down the street by gravity to the lowest spot in your neighborhood. And in Somerset, we have 26 of those areas. We call them collection sub-basins. And so this study monitored those 26 sub-basins and found that 7 sub-basins had excessive infiltration. This is groundwater that's seeping in. And 12 sub-basins had a combined 80% of the system's inflow. So 12 sub-basins were bad for stormwater getting in. Okay. And they also identified that the inflow had a delay. So they measure when a storm occurs, and then they measure the flow in the system. And that delay indicates that it was due to sump pumps, a number of sump pumps. So they made some nice diagrams, and we'll go through those. So the map on the left highlights all the 26 sub-basins in different colors, and they rank them red as being bad, yellow as being moderate, and green as being okay. This map's a little bit misleading because some of the yellow subbasins are actually red. If you look to the map on your right, you see M15 kind of in the middle of the screen there. It has red hash marks on it. So that's also a high priority. That would be considered a red basin as well, a subbasin. Okay. I just want to point out some of these subbasins here. On the map on the left, at the top of your screen, you see a red subbasin that's identified as M4. I'm not sure if you can make that out, but that's M4. And at the bottom of the town, the south end of the town near Brenton Point, is another red subbasin, and that's identified as M21. Okay. And then on the map to the right, kind of in the elbow of Somerset, where it wraps around Swansea, you see M15 and M16. Okay. And then on the top of that same image, you see M11. Okay. It's a yellow subbasin with the red hash marks. These are the highest priorities, okay, that we're actually focusing on now with a new project. Just to give you an idea of what those areas are in town. And so they put together this table. So this is a table of subbasins that have high groundwater infiltration. Okay, so you see at the top of the list, M15 and M16 and M11, okay, and then M6 and M23. Those are high priorities, and we're embarking on a project to handle the three top ones. And then there's some yellow ones there. But you see, a large portion of the town is actually okay. Inflow. This table shows subbasins that have high stormwater infiltration, okay? So again, at the top of the list, you see M16, and then M21, that was at the south end of town, and then M4, which is at the north end of town, okay? And then M12 is sort of in the middle of the town. But you see that these red subbasins account for 57% of the inflow. And that when you include the yellow subbasins as well, then it accounts for 82% of the inflow. So, about half of the subbasins in town need attention. So wastewater flows downhill, okay, to the low spot in the neighborhood or the subbasin, and then we tend to have a pump station that moves it south. The wastewater in Somerset tends to move west to east down towards the Taunton River and from north to south down towards the treatment facility. So the picture on your left is one of our larger pump stations. And you may not notice because a lot of these are disguised and look like small houses. What you don't realize is that there's two or three stories of substantial infrastructure underground. And the image on your right shows a cross-sectional view of a pump station. And the top portion is the entry building, okay? That's above grade. And then the rest of it is below grade, underground. The long vertical triangle that's highlighted in black on the right is what's called a wet well, and that's where the wastewater would collect. Okay. And then the area to the left of that is a dry well, and that's where our pumps and controls are positioned so that we can work on that equipment without having to enter the hazardous area. So in Somerset, we have 17 pump stations, and Wright-Pierce listed all of these out, gave a description of the type of pumping system that each station has, the year it went online, the year of the last upgrade, its capacity, and then it gave a point score for all these other categories like condition, age, its capacity, safety concerns, instrumentation and controls, standby power, locational impact, sea level rise, and hurricane surge. So then they totaled up all of these scores and gave it a point total to do this ranking. So the Main Street Station, this is located in Waterfront Park near the north end of town. This is one of our high priority stations that needs work. Route 6 is part of this project that we're kicking off this spring. We're going to do a rehabilitation of the wet well there. And last year we upgraded the generator. Pleasant and number 5, Pilot, are sister type stations. They're very similar to one another, and we plan to do that work shortly after the main project. Okay. Wilbur Avenue, if Route 6 comes out as good as we expect, we'll do the same type of work for Wilbur Avenue, and we could probably do that within our operating budget. And then you see Pump Station 6 is Gay Street, and then Cherry Street, Durfee Court, Owen Avenue. Those are all small stations. They're all very similar, kind of in configuration, and we plan to include those with this project. Because we think we can do one kind of basic design and tailor it to each site. And then there'll also be somewhat like package treatment pump stations. So we think we can save some money by lumping them all together in the contract, in the project. And then pump station 10 to 17, those are all in fairly good condition. There's some minor improvements that we would include with the project that we'll get to at this next slide here. So this slide, let me just catch up here. So you see second from the top is Cherry Street. That's one of those smaller stations, and that's just shy of $1 million, we estimate, to design and build that. And then Durfee Court is a similar one to that, and Gay Street, about halfway down the list. And then where are we at here? Main Street is about 3/4 of the way down the list. That's about $2 million to replace that station. And we also may look at moving that slightly because right now it's in a flood zone and it's in an area where it's in a park. And so it's kind of obtrusive in that park. So look at doing that. And then Owen Avenue is two below Main Street, and that's about $1 million that we're going to include that one. And then we'll include some of these high priority items on our larger stations. So we estimate that the pump station work as part of this project is about $10 million. Two of that $10 million is in engineering costs, and $8 million will be in construction. This is an aerial photo of the treatment facility. And I just want to point out a couple of things to kind of give you a little understanding of the plan here. Those square dark rectangles, the four square rectangles across the middle there, and the two circular tanks to the right, that was the original treatment plant. That was the aeration basins and the settling basins. The tanks below that, the rectangular tanks below those four lighter rectangles, that's the present secondary aeration tanks. That's where we grow the microorganisms and remove the dissolved solids. And then to the right of that are the clarifiers that separate the microorganisms from the treated effluent. Okay. And now we use those older tanks, those dark tanks, as equalization basins. So when we have these big storm surges, we divert the flow into those tanks, and then we treat it when it's dry. So we very rarely overflow the treatment plant and discharge untreated sewage into the Taunton River. That almost never happens. Never say never, though. So the darker buildings, the roofs with the darker roof buildings, those are original buildings to the plant. And then the wider roofs are fairly new buildings. So this slide maps the flow from 2016 through 2018. The dark line across the middle is our permit limit. It's 4.2 million gallons a day. And what you see is you see these high peaks, you know, 6 to 7 million gallons a day. That's stormwater. And then some of the wider peaks would tend to be groundwater, periods of very wet periods where we have high groundwater. What's interesting to point out is the low loops at the bottom. You know, they all drop down to about 2 million gallons a day. So when it's dry and there's not storms, when we're just treating sewage, we're treating about 2 million gallons a day. And that's about what we put out at the water treatment plant, the drinking water plant. So those numbers should be pretty close. All the additional flow we're seeing is due to INI, infiltration and inflow. And so if we can mitigate that, drop those peaks down, we'll have plenty of capacity in the system for additional customers. This slide indicates the requirements of our existing discharge permit. Okay, they call it a NPDES permit. And so the first row underneath the headings there, influent flow, you can see that's 4.2 million gallons a day. That's an annual average. And then the third row is BOD. BOD is a measure of oxygen demand in the wastewater. So this is our effluent that goes out to the Taunton River, and we're allowed 30 milligrams per liter. That's basically saying that we're going to the wastewater can consume 30 milligrams of oxygen per liter. But we tend to be below that number, well below that number. So, but that's what BOD stands for. TSS is total suspended solids, and that again is 30. These numbers are likely to be decreased with our new permit. And then you see near the bottom there, total ammonia nitrogen and total cajadol nitrogen. There's no numbers in this table for those parameters, and we'll likely see those. We will see those with the new permit. And the plant isn't designed to remove those contaminants. So. All right. This treatment plant is a very dynamic and complex system. And I just want to go through all the systems and processes, or some of the systems and processes, to give you an idea of the extent of complexity to this plant. So the wastewater comes into the plant, and there's a stage called preliminary treatment, where we're removing rags and grit and wipes. We're tending to see a lot of wipes. I think it's because of the pandemic. And if you can refrain from throwing those down the drain, it will save a lot of time in operation and maintenance and repair costs at our plant. And then also in this stage, we monitor flow. Then the wastewater moves to the primary clarifiers, and this is where we're settling out the settleable solids. Okay, and what's going to settle the big chunks, you know, settle out to the bottom and are removed as sludge. And then whatever floats to the surface is removed as scum. So we have a scum removal process, a sludge removal process, and then the mechanics of the clarifier itself. Then the wastewater moves to a secondary aeration system. And this is where we're growing the microorganisms to feed on the dissolved solids. And then this process develops sludge that has to be removed and processed. And then the wastewater moves to the secondary clarifiers. And this is where we're separating the microorganisms from the treated wastewater. Again, we're removing sludge and removing scum off the top. So all the sludge from the plant goes to a sludge thickening process and then on to a solids handling process where we squeeze the liquid out of the sludge and produce what's called a cake that we can dispose of. The wastewater then moves on to a disinfection process and a neutralization process to take out excess chlorine. All of these different processes have electrical systems and motor control panels and backup generators. We also have monitoring instruments and control systems. We have odor control systems. We have all these different buildings that have their own mechanical systems, plumbing and electrical and drainage and heating systems and air handling systems. So there's a lot to this plant. And I just want to show you some pictures to give you a sense of what this plant looks like. So this image on the left here is in our preliminary treatment building. And this is a 65-year-old building. And you can see how dirty and dingy this is. This is not a very pleasant place to work. And the image on the right there with the chain and the sprockets, this is a mechanism that removes the grit that accumulates at the bottom of these tanks. So the chains drag the, you see at the top of the image, it's a paddle. It's called a flight or a rake. It moves those along and scrapes across the bottom of the tank and then brings up that material into a hopper. But you can see the housing is rusty and rotted, and the sprockets have been replaced. The chain is old. The flights break, and we have to repair those. There's just a lot of downtime. These pieces of equipment break down quite often because of their age. The pink image there in the lower right. Is a door to this facility. It's a metal door that's rusted out at the bottom. You can also see the frame of the door that's rotted out. This image shows a motor control panel on the left there. And this is 35-year-old equipment. It may be 60-year-old equipment, but regardless, we can't get parts for it anymore. When we have to repair something, we look for used reconditioned parts. And those aren't always available. And so it's just seeing its useful life there. The image on the right is a rake arm from our primary clarifier. This is 1/4-inch thick steel. And you can see it's totally rotted out there in the middle. What we ended up having to do is drain this 15-foot deep tank, pump out all the sludge in the bottom, set up scaffolding, cut off this whole end arm assembly, send it to a fabricator to custom make a new piece, put it in position, weld it back up, and then put the tank back online. And all of that takes a lot of time and extra money because it's custom fabrication. You can't buy these parts anymore. And so this is just showing you that this plant has run its course. It's beyond its useful life. The image on the left is our solids processing unit. These are called belt filter presses, and they have basically two belts that run together. The sludge is in the middle, and it squeezes the water out. These are very complex pieces of equipment. You can see, you know, there's numerous electrical conduits and motors and gears and switches and solenoids and valves. It's good that we have two of them because usually one of them's down for repairs. These units are beyond their life. These are 35-year-old units, and there is new technology out there that's much more reliable, much more simplistic in its operation. So the maintenance is a lot less. I know my plant operator, Harry Gracia, is looking, can't wait till this facility is upgraded because he spends a lot of time repairing these units. The image on the right is a valve in one of our aeration tanks. And you can see how old that valve is. We call it a gate. And then you can also see the concrete that these tanks are made out of. The concrete has been eroded away over the years, and you can see the aggregate, the rock that's in the concrete being exposed now. So these tanks need to be resurfaced as part of the upgrade. So the engineer have done a very thorough evaluation and developed this cost estimate of the various treatment processes and arrived at a project total of close to $58 million. Okay. Now, $9 million is related to engineering and $49 million is due to construction, okay, so for a project total of $58 million. But you can see, I think the biggest line item here is the solids handling, $17 million for solids handling. And those are those presses that we just looked at. So total project costs. So we have $11 million for the engineering work. That's $9 million on the plant and $2 million on the pump stations. $8 million for the pump station upgrade work, the construction portion of that. And then $49 million for the construction at the treatment plant. Okay, so for a total project cost of about $68 million. Okay. So this information in this engineering assessment was critical in understanding these numbers in developing our financial plan, and which is the next stage. Okay. So the first thing that's going to happen is EPA is going to issue us a draft permit. And we're going to tell them we can't meet, our treatment plant can't meet the limits in that permit. And then we negotiate a timeline to build the new plant. And so the board has already appropriated funds to do that permit negotiation. That's a very critical piece because it sets up our timeline. And we really don't have time to wait on that. I think we have to respond within 30 days of getting that draft permit. The next phase is the design, the engineering work, okay? And the engineering work is not eligible for the state revolving loan fund. We have to borrow from the open market and at interest rates of around roughly 4.5%, okay? And then the construction phase, again, that would be borrowed from the state revolving loan fund. We were looking at how the timelines of the borrowing, the rate increases to cover these expenses and the timing of all of those things would impact. We needed to come up with a financial plan. So we were looking for a tool to do that. And we found this tool called Waterworth. And so JP Jolly helped us come up with this model. We took all our operation and maintenance data for the last couple of years, put it in this model, and then a lot of this information from this engineering assessment. And what we were able to do is develop different scenarios. And so we don't really know when EPA is going to make up their mind and present us with a permit. We have an idea of when that is, or a good guess, because we talk to the regulatory agencies regularly. But if we have a scenario set up that if we get that permit, that draft permit within the next year, we have a scenario for that. Okay. Unfortunately, it results in steep rate increases to be able to accommodate that. And then the one piece that we looked at a variety of different ways is the borrowing for the engineering work. Because we have to go to the open market and we have to start with that, we were looking at different ways. We thought about saving for all of that, the $11 million for the engineering work. That resulted in substantial rate increases right off the bat. And then we also looked at borrowing for all of those, all of that cost, all that $11 million. And we also looked at the impact to rates over a 10-year period for these various scenarios. And what we realized is scenario four made the most sense. We figure that the project will start in about 3 years. This will allow us some gradual rate increases until we get hit with that EPA mandate. By then, we'll have some money stored, saved for to start on the engineering work, and it'll also allow us some time to set up our financing for the engineering work and the construction. So what we'd like to do is present scenario four. So this is the output of the model, and I'll step you through the various elements of it. So what we have here on the bottom of the graph, the dark blue band, is our operation and maintenance budget. Okay. So right now, our operation and maintenance budget is about $3 million a year. The gold vertical bars is our annual revenue. Okay. So you can see in 2020, in that area, we're just slightly above our operation and maintenance budget on our revenues. And then the red bars is the borrowing. So we have $4.5 million in 2025 and another $4.5 million in 2026. That's the engineering piece broken in two parts. Okay. And then the following year, we have half of the treatment plant plus the $8 million in pump station costs. So that's 25 plus eight. So $33 million, right? And then the next year is the other half of the treatment plant, which is $24 million. Okay. So during this whole time, we're increasing the rates, okay? And the dark green indicates capital improvements, okay? So we're borrowing money for during those times, or we're making capital improvements, rather. And then when we're borrowing, that's indicated by the red, we're rolling that over then in a debt service or a mortgage. And that's indicated by the light blue color. Okay. So what we need to have happen is when we're done with the project, the gold bars need to cover our operating costs and our debt service. Okay. The dark blue and the light blue. And so when you see right around 2030, you see that gold bar is the right height. Okay. Also of concern is, you can see my arrow here at the bottom, this debt service coverage window. Okay. We want to make sure that our debt service coverage, this is a ratio that should be above one. Should be like 1.25 or 1.1. Lenders look at that indicator to make sure that our revenues are sufficient to cover our expenses. Okay. So this green little hump here, this is the pump station work that we have planned after the project's completed. Okay, this is Pleasant Street, Pilot Street, and some other ancillary pump station work. So, all right. This slide identifies the rate increases to achieve to generate the revenue to cover the project. Okay, so you can see here in 2022. We're going to do, that's July 1st of this year. This is fiscal year. We're anticipating a 5% rate increase. And then 2023 is another 5%. And then 2024 is when we anticipate the project to begin. And then we'll do a 15% rate increase. And then 2025 is when we start the engineering work. A 20% rate increase followed by an 18% rate increase. Okay, so the idea is to ramp this up to allow people to adjust their finances and to give people some time to adjust to this increase. I've spoke with some other towns and some towns have done very substantial rate increases, 80%, 100%, right off the bat in 1 year. And the board wanted this to be as gentle increase as possible. There's no other way. There's plants all over the country are in the same boat. These were put in the 60s. They're worn out and they need to be rebuilt. And so there's no grant funding for this magnitude of a project. If it were, the federal government would be broke, as everybody would be there. So that's what we have in this scenario, these types of rate increases. And what's nice about this program is if things change a little bit, we can just jump right in and JP's there to help me tweak things a little bit as we get new information, or maybe, you know, we have another year where we're not getting the permit. So we just, we could knock this 15% down if we didn't get the permit. Do another 5% rate increase. So, we can see the effect of the output of the model. So, very useful tool. The water meter replacement project is very critical to the sewer department. The water department had a mishmash of different brands of water meters, ranging in age from 60 years to the present. And it's a very complicated process to read all of those meters. We had four different ways that we would collect the reads and then enter them into our billing program. We would have cards that customers would fill out. And then they would be writing the number in off of their meter, and then we would be typing that number into our billing system. And there's room for transcription of those numbers by doing that type of process. We would also have our own staff going out and taking reads directly off the meters. We have a touch read device where we go up to the house and there's an outside register that we plug in an instrument and it collects the read. And that's a little bit better system because we don't have to actually write down the read. There's less chance of transcribing the numbers. And then we have people calling and giving us the read that we write in. But all of these different processes for collecting the reads took a long time. So it would take us 4 months to read the town. And that just prevented us from reading more often or billing more often. And so this new metering system, we should be able to read the town in 3 days. And they're all the same brand of meter. They're all read the same way. They're all the same age. So it's going to be a much more efficient process for reading the meters and then generating the bills. The water that's used, that's consumed from the water system that runs through the the water meters is a great tool to bill for sewer. Right now I'm getting ahead of myself, but we'll get to the next slide and I'll explain that line. But so we're going to have, we'll end up having better water use data, from this new billing system. Okay. So, the meters are 90% completed. We have 90% of the meters in place and, we expect the remainder, to be done by this fall. All right. Sewer rate design. So, as rates increase due to taking on all of this debt, we're looking at ways where we can restructure the sewer rates, to make it more fair to customers. So, it's right now we have, a flat rate of $85 a quarter, which is $340 a year, regardless of how much water you use or sewer you put down your drains. And we would like to shift that a bit to be more in line with how much water you're using. Okay, so the customers that are using more water and discharging more sewer will pay more. And it's a more equitable rate structure. But to start redesigning that rate structure, we need good data, water use data, and that will come in the next year with these meters. So that's something that is on my to-do list with Waterworth in this next year. The image on the right is a sewer rate survey that's done every few years in Massachusetts. And so a company goes out, surveys all the towns, asks them what their sewer rates are and how they're structured, and then puts this report together. And what you can see is that in 2017, the average sewer bill in Massachusetts was $862 a year. Okay. Now, some towns are less than that, like Somerset. In 2019, our average bill is just under $550 a year. Okay. And some towns are more than that average number. Okay. And the towns that are more are the towns that have a new plant. They've gone through this upgrade. So we're on the bottom end of the scale because we have an older plant, and we're ready to, we're making plans to make this upgrade. So, all right, infiltration and inflow mitigation. So as we saw in the slide on the plant flow, the graph over the 2016 and 2018, we have substantial amount of infiltration and inflow into the sewer system. And this creates surges at the plant. And this is a primary concern when we go to construction, because half of the plant is going to be under construction while the other half is treating the wastewater. And it's such a small site, it would be very helpful to reduce some of these this INI. And so we are working on a project to do that. It will also reduce our pump station costs or our pumping costs. So again, we're pumping wastewater and this groundwater and stormwater from one pump station to the next pump station to the next pump station and down the line to the treatment plant, and then pumping it a number of times at the treatment plant. So if it's groundwater and stormwater, it doesn't need to be in there. We can eliminate that and save on electrical costs. And then third, it will reduce our capacity to allow more customers in. So this spring, we will start on our first phase of INI repairs. We're focusing on sub-basins M4, M11, M15, M16, and M21. We're also going to be doing the repairs to the Route 6 pump station, and we anticipate this project being $1.3 million. Half of this project has been funded from a grant, from a federal grant from EDA. Okay. And, so If we anticipate conservatively that we'll reduce 50% of the INI from these sub-basins, and that would amount to about 260,000 gallons a day of groundwater getting into the system or infiltration, and roughly 1.6 million gallons of inflow from storm events. So regionalization and future development. So if we remove our INI, we will have plenty capacity at our plant. We don't expect that in the new permit that our capacity of our plant will increase. It should stay the same. But the idea of regionalization is to bring in more customers so we have the debt spread out amongst more users. More users, everybody pay, as a result, everybody will pay less. So we've been talking with Swansea and Dighton. The town has also been pursuing new developments in the town and at Brenton Point. You know, when those power plants closed, the water department lost 60% of its revenue, and the sewer, another large piece of that revenue. And so we're looking at bringing customers back into the system to share in that debt burden. So that's the idea behind regionalization. So Swansea is interested. We've been negotiating an agreement with them, and we should have some details on that shortly. We've also spoken to Dighton, and they're looking at doing a sewer project. They're not sure the extent and where the funds would come from. So finally, some other efforts. We've been going on some plant tours, and recently we did a tour and a presentation at Uxbridge. Uxbridge has built a new plant. They've gone through this process, and what I've took away from that presentation is that we're doing all the right steps, and I think we're actually ahead of the game. We're not going to hit our customers with a huge rate increase right off the bat if we can't. So we're going to ramp things up, and with this financial plan, we know what those increases need to be. Also on these new plant tours, we've been looking at new equipment. The different types of equipment that are there, that's out there to treat sludge or different processes for secondary treatment. You know, all the different equipment components that go into a new plant. So we're asking new plants how they like it and how it's working out if it's, so we're getting some ideas on what we need. So before I open it up to comments and questions, I'd like to just make a few acknowledgments. I'd like to thank the Board of Commissioners for their vision and direction and guidance in developing this plan and helping to see it through. I'd also like to thank our host, Lori Belcher of SATV, for hosting all of these sessions. I'd like to also thank our other panelists, Kevin Olson from Wright Pierce and JP Jolly from Waterworth. So now we'll open it up to questions and comments. I need to bring up my chat here.
I don't see anything in the chat right now.
Okay. I think they're used to raising their hands. A couple of people have their hands raised to actually speak and ask their question. I think that way. Some of them are on cell phones, and sometimes it's hard to send a text message that way by using the chat on a small phone. So I don't know if you want to answer them that way.
Sure.
Is that so, okay? So do you see?
Yep.
So you have, do you want to take them in order as they came? Because they'll show up in your video as how they came in order.
Sure.
Okay. So we Kathy Souza. So let me have her unmute and we'll lower her hand. Oops. Who did I unmute by mistake? Let's see. Kathy, hold on. And there we go. Okay. Kathy, there you go. Hey.
Thanks, Laurie. Can you hear me?
Yep.
Yes.
Okay, because it still shows me as muted. I have a few questions, but I'll try and be quick. Have upgrades been made right along? Like in just the last 10 years, have we been making upgrades right along?
Yes.
Yeah.
We have to keep the plant operating. So anything that's necessary to keep the plant operating, we've done. There's a number of major pieces of equipment that we've replaced in the last few years.
Okay, so let's pretend that there's no EPA permit coming. How long would everything last? Say there's no EPA permit coming. What do you anticipate the shelf life of everything?
So, some of the things that are new, would have a much longer shelf life than things that haven't been replaced. But, I would say that if a permit didn't come, we would look at upgrading the solids processing process. I know that's a big portion of the overall project, but it's probably the most labor intensive.
And do you anticipate the entire $62 million as an absolute that EPA would require? Or is part of that like wish list? But is part of it wish list items and part of it something EPA specifically would say is needed?
Hey, Bob, can I help along with that?
Sure, Scott.
Okay, so Kathy, some of the things as we talked about, this plant is over 60 years old. A lot of the infrastructure part, the concrete itself is failing, which is the lion's share of the whole plant. Mm-hmm. So all the mechanicals, all the stuff that's around it, the basic infrastructure, the concrete, the base, the hardcore part of the plant is failing in itself. So the question that you're asking is can we keep putting Band-Aids on it? Absolutely. We changed a few very big screw pumps, which was over $1 million. We've done three pump station replacements significantly. All those are things that we've done along the way. We've paid as we went. But at this point, it's just failing. It's like having that old Chevy truck car where the fenders, the frame is just rotted out. Can we rebuild the frame? Yes. Well, we have to take the body off, dig everything out, rebuild it, then put it all back on. So we are beyond that scope. That's why as a board, we're trying to be proactive, knowing that no matter what, even without the EPA permit, which we know is inevitable, that's not going to not be. It's going to be. They're already dealing with it in Taunton. We talked about that once before. And Taunton has postponed it. But eventually it's going to come. But what we're doing now is being very proactive of how we're going to do this, trying to put our, like the old way of Somerset doing business, trying to pay as we go. And now we're trying to build that nest egg so that we can get to where we have to be.
Okay. But the nest egg, I mean, even over the course of 5 years, is almost a 20% increase to the residents, which is a lot for somebody with a fixed income. So that's
why I agree.
So how long is Taunton being able to hold off the EPA, as you say? How many years?
I think they're at 5 years. I think they're at 5 years now.
Okay. And is there communication between yourselves and the EPA regarding this permit?
Yeah. Well, no. we speak with MassDEP regularly. And
we're not poking the dog.
The MassDEP.
Agreed. And that's my question. Is there correspondence going back and forth?
Absolutely. Yes. Absolutely.
There is.
And Taunton is, their process is dragged out because they're taking EPA to court. And, they have the deep pockets, I guess, to do that. Once that's settled, that may work in Somerset's favor. But.
Okay. Sorry, I just wrote down my questions as you were going through the slides. So One of the questions I have is, do we have enough property for the upgrade?
So National Grid owns a big portion of property to the south of the plant, and we've reached out to them, and they're willing to lease us a portion of that during the construction.
So is that like the property that's past Walker Street, like towards under the bridge, like the Bragg Bridge, or what property?
Yeah. Yes. Kathy, it's directly adjacent to the existing plant, closest to us.
So is that actually, are they marking that out right now?
No. Nope.
Because I know they've been under there. There's markings under there. I was just curious.
Yeah, no.
Yeah. No, I think we probably should move on to some other people first, Kathy, and then we can vote come back to you, just so that we can be fair and honest with everybody.
Well, I only have a couple more questions. Just a quick, how much INI do we get, like, in the worst month? And because I do manage wastewater at my position right now. Just, so, is there somewhere I can find that number?
That graph that we showed you?
Yeah, can this presentation somewhere?
Yep.
Yeah.
Okay, so, and then who do I email for the rest of my questions?
You can send them to me.
Okay, great.
And my name is on the town website.
Yep, I have
my
it.
My email address. Yeah.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, Kathy.
Yep, you're welcome. Thank you.
Next person is Pat's iPhone. Okay, she's unmuted.
Hello. Pat? Can you hear me?
Yes. Hi, Pat.
Hello. So I don't know if this is relevant to this meeting. I just wanted to know, is Brayton Point LLC, are they paying, are they on a meter for the water that they're using from the hydrants and for filling up their water trucks? Is the town charging them for that?
We got two.
You guys are charging them for that?
Yes.
And then how about if they're filling up potable water to the ships? Are they getting charged for that too? Do you know if they're doing that?
We have master meters for their whole complex. So any water that they use from their hydrants or any of the buildings on their property runs through those master meters.
And then say a commodities port never goes there and there's a business that's really heavily water dependent again, and we enter into agreements with Swansea and Dighton, will these plants be able to hold like a capacity of, say it wasn't like you said 60% was Brayton Point, say a business goes there and it's like 35%, would tying in the other towns overtax the system, or would it be okay? Does anybody know, or is that just too hard to predict?
I can tell you that when the power plant was in place, they actually had their own septic system, their own plant, their own small treatment plant down at the plant.
Yeah, they got rid of that though. So,
so whoever goes in there could certainly be, you know, whatever they decide to do and how they do it. This could be all part of their master plan.
Okay.
So, we're not going to make any agreements with neighboring towns that we can't honor, you know, that we don't have the capacity for.
Okay. Thank you very much. That's all I got.
You have a typed question from Lloyd. Did you get that already, Bob?
No, I'm not seeing that in my chat.
Did anybody else get that? Okay, let me hang on, Bob. I'll send it to you. Let's see.
Okay, I see that now.
Okay, that's from Lloyd Mendes.
Okay. I'll just read out the question. Will the rebuilt sewer control facility be in the FEMA flood zone now that it's been raised? Will the new facility be in the expected flood zone based on the predicted sea level rise for the expected life of this new facility? I'm worried about the need to move the facility in 20 years if flood levels rise as expected. Kevin, do you want to address this? Because I think you handle these with other towns.
Yeah, that's a really good question. The short answer is part of the design, the engineer, the consultant would have to take a look at what the then, you know, 100, 500 year flood elevations are, and compared to what the existing tops of concrete finished floor levels are. And right now DEP requires 100 year flood elevation plus 3 feet. You know, that is their guideline. So that would have to be evaluated as part of preliminary design. And if some facilities, some buildings, some tanks don't, you know, meet that requirement, they would have to be raised accordingly. I don't want to bore people with a lot of details, but there are other things that can be done. We actually are relocating a pump station now down in Cape Cod, and we actually have put barricades in front of doors. So there's a number of other things you can do. You have to balance cost as well, but that's an important part given the location of the plant, and certainly a key issue that will be addressed. We've taken a look at it right now, but you know, give it a little bit more time. It'll have to be really finalized during design phase.
Thank you, Kevin.
Okay, we have Ed Souza.
Hi, guys.
Hi, Ed.
Thanks for taking the time and holding these meetings. They're very informative. Hey, I just got a question about, you know, with these type of facilities, I know that you need to keep backup equipment kind of in stock, like pumps and different things and your parts, your extra parts. What are we keeping for a value on the shelf right now? Is it $10,000? Is it $100,000?
I mean, I don't have that number off the top of my head.
Just a ballpark figure would be.
Yeah. I would say, you know, somewhere in the range of $50,000 to $100,000. You know, some of the smaller pumps that we have backups for. You know, a lot of these stations and these pumping systems have dual pumps, you know, just in case one fails. You know,
take them out, rebuild it and put it back in, and you don't have to keep something on the shelf. I totally get that.
A lot of them are redundant.
Sure.
Yeah. A lot of them are redundant systems.
Sure. And with the new plant, is that included in the price, like the backup equipment that you're going to have to purchase? And again, can you, with that is, does this plant come with the redundancy of the extra pump and everything? That's all in the plan. The plan. I know that. No, I'm not talking about anything that's out in the town of Somerset. That all staying the same and stuff. Right? But how much is part of that plan putting extra stock on a shelf also?
I mean, these are estimate numbers. These are preliminary numbers, and I think, you know, as we develop the plans and specifications during the design, we can require the contractor to include some replacement parts as part of their bid. Obviously that number would be higher because we want those parts, but I think it's a good idea just so that we have them available. You know, and these are preliminary numbers again. So, you know,
sure, yeah,
we have to actually go out to bid for all of this work and see what the actual numbers come in.
Well, the only reason I asked the question is to make sure that you guys think about it when you're formalizing this plan. I guess my last question, and it's an overall question, and you guys might have thought of this and maybe not, but have we thought about getting out of this business of sewer and tying into Fall River, and what would that be? And
we have.
And just being a water department.
Hey, we sure did. And I thought when somebody first gave us that, somebody first brought that up, I thought that was one of the greatest ideas I've ever heard in my life, where we could just take one line, stick it across the river, hook up the Fall River and say, here we go, how much we owe you this year? Well, when we asked that question, it almost tripled it was more than triple of what we pay right now.
Right.
So you guys did a study on that? So
we told them what we had for flow, what we would give them, and they gave us a price of what it would cost us per year.
Right.
Okay. And that's something you guys can show. Like if you had to present this if you had to present that, you could show that number compared to what it would cost to build a new plant and say, hey, we're saving $80 million.
Yeah.
And I mean, I can tell you right now, Hold on, Bob. I don't mean to interrupt you, but I can tell you, Ed, right now, I'll tell you what it was. We're at $3 million a year. They were at $8 million at our lowest flow possible.
And we would have to pay for the line to go across the river and then down to their treatment plant. So it was like a 6-mile run. And it's not cheap.
And that's an actual number. That's not pie in the sky. That's if you called Forever and asked them what they told us, I'm sure they, I would hope that they would tell you the same thing that you told us.
I'm not going to call them. I believe that what you're telling me is to be true.
But you're right. I thought that was the greatest idea ever.
Yeah. And that,
watch my hands for it.
And that rate, did you think that that rate was extremely high?
Yes.
And where are we, when we go to charge, you know, Dighton and Swansea, are we close to that rate or are we much lower than that rate to tie in?
I'm not sure what you mean by that.
Well,
Fall River
was going to charge us. I didn't exactly hear the rate, but you guys said it was extremely high and it wouldn't be worth it. So we should rebuild the plant. And we're going to charge Swansea to tie in, correct? That's one of the things that we want to do when we have all this capacity so we can drive our rates down. I'm just wondering what the difference is between what we're going to charge Swansea to what Fall River is going to charge us.
It's a little bit different.
I'd have to look at that. I don't have those numbers with me. So, but okay. I mean, well,
per thousand. Like per cubic, like
Okay. Yep. Maybe I'll rephrase the question and we'll email it to you.
Yeah, that's fine.
Okay. Thanks, guys. I appreciate
Thank
it.
You. You're welcome.
I don't see any more hands raised, and I didn't see any more text.
Yeah.
So, okay. If you want to call to people, if anybody has any questions.
Yeah. If anybody's got any last questions. Please ask him now.
Hey Bob, can you verbally say your email address so that if someone wanted to take it in, they could?
Yes.
It'd be tough. No. Yeah. Maybe you want to make a sign and get up.
I tend to use my Gmail account. It's R. And then my last name, bozikowski@gmail.com.
I just sent it to everybody in the chat.
Okay.
It looks like there's no more questions.
Okay, great. Okay, well, for that being said, I think we'll close this meeting. We will be closing this meeting. So I'd like to have a motion to close the meeting, please.
I make a motion to close the meeting.
Do I have a second? I don't know if Joe's out there. If not, Joe, I'll second it.
I'm here. I have a second.
Okay. All those in favor, roll call vote.
Benavides, aye.
Bednarik, aye.
And O'Brien, I thank you very much, everybody, for being at our meeting today. Thank you.
Thank Good you, guys. Night. You guys thank have you. A nice night.
You yeah, too. You too. Thank you, everybody.
Thanks, everybody.
Take care.
Thanks, Kevin. Thanks, JP.
Yeah, thank you, guys.
Thank you, guys. Thank you very much.
Lori, good job.
Thank you, Lori.
You're welcome.
Always the best.
Thank you.
So Lori.
Have a nice one. Yes.
You too.
The attendees for the three meetings and any questions that you get, and then how do I log into the video?